Natalie spent a lifetime making art and in art education. She received a special citation by the New York State Art Teachers Association for significant contribution to the field of art education in the state of New York. She's also past president of the University Council for Art Education. As an artist, she was the recipient of three residencies at Skidmore College and was awarded a residency at the Fundación Valparaíso in Spain. She's married to an artist, and she has raised a family of artists. And she's my good friend. Welcome.
Thank you all for coming. The reason I decided to do this talk actually goes back a few years ago. I was leading an art tour for AAUW, American Association of University Women, and we were doing the 57th Street galleries. And one of the galleries I chose was a printmaking gallery. And when I got up there with the ladies, most of them did not understand. They saw they had seen prints, but they didn't really understand what a print was. They didn't understand how you value a print. They didn't understand the varieties of printmaking. And so I decided to put together a talk for AAUW on what is a print and what's the difference between a fine art print and a print that you see on posters and what have you. So that's how this lecture came about. I am a printmaker, I guess I got my master's in printmaking. Not I guess, I did. and I love doing it. What I love about printmaking is the creative process, but what I also love about printmaking, and most people who are really involved in it, it really hits both sides of your brain. I used to tell my students, I'm two personalities. I like things wrapped up in a package with a bow on top, but then there's the crazy side of me. Well, that's what printing allows you to do, because when you get started, you have to know the process of printmaking, and you have to pre-visualize. And then, once you get started, then you can really go crazy with it. What is a print? A fine art print is an original artwork that is created to be printed in multiples. It's not a reproduction of an existing artwork created in another medium, such as a drawing or a painting or a sculpture. So you've seen prints, but if they are a print of a painting, it's not a fine art print. Each print is considered unique. It's a unique work of art, technically known as an impression. Now, here's some of the terminology of proof. A proof is an impression made from a plate, and I do have over there some plates. I have a woodblock plate, and I have etching plates. Made from a plate, a block, a screen, or any other printing methods. And there are different types of prints. One is called the trial or the working proof, and sometimes it's called the state. It's as the print progresses. The artist proof, when the artist signs a print, and when they make an addition, they're able to take outside of the addition, they are able to take a certain amount of proofs on their own. It should never be more than 10 or 15%. And when they do it, you'll see AP. So when you see at the bottom, usually there's the way it's written, you'll see at the bottom AP if it's an artist proof. And then there's another kind of a proof that's outside of the edition, and that's called the presentation proof. And that's if an artist actually, I'm going to give a proof to Hilda, and I write to Hilda on her 50th wedding anniversary, and then signing. So that's outside of the addition, and it's a presentation proof. And then lastly, there's the printer's proof. So when an artist works with a master printer, they are able, the printer is allowed to keep a certain amount of prints. Again, it's outside of the addition, because when we talk about an addition, and we start talking about the value of a print, you have to know about the size of the print. So an addition is the number of identical impressions that are pulled. When you make a print, it's saying you're pulling a print, that are pulled from a plate, a block, a screen, or any other means of making multiple copies. These do not include trial proofs, artist proofs, and any other proofs outside of the edition.
What's the difference between a trial proof and an artist proof? Because it's
the artist proof is usually the last proof.
Oh.
But the trial proofs are
the
ones that some of the ones that are available to you to take are proofs that somebody made but doesn't want to include them in the edition because of one reason or another. It's so that they're just trial, they're testing it out. Maybe testing out a color or changing things.
Here. Now, what determines how many proofs you get from a particular edition? I see numbers, for example, 21 out of 32.
Yeah, I'm going to talk about that, but what determines it? The artist determines how many, what edition he's going to make. So I'm sort of getting ahead of myself, but it's all part of this. So if you're looking to buy a print, and it's one out of 1,010, or 900 out of 1,010, it's not going to be as valuable as a print that was less of an edition and an earlier print. Part of the reason being an earlier print, especially say if it was from a copper plate, copper plates only allow a certain amount of prints to be made, not allow, the really sharp prints, there's a small amount because copper is more malleable. On a zinc plate, you can do even more prints. So that's why the earlier ones are what people like because they are the most pristine.
Yes, I was thinking, okay, so I'm an artist, say, and I say, I'm going to make 30.
Yeah.
And I start signing them one out of 30, two out of 30, but they're not selling. So it turns out to be an addition of 5 instead of 30.
But it can still be an addition of 30, but you just haven't made the rest of it. I have things that I've made that I have not made the whole addition or sold the whole addition. And in fact, I'm sort of getting ahead of myself, but that's all right. According to what you're supposed to do is after an addition is made, say you're working with a master printer, 250 prints, you're really supposed to, what's called strike the print.
You're
supposed to put either an X or something so that one cannot print. If somebody got hold of the plate, they could not print anymore. So.
Natalie, could you backtrack? You said something that 10 is the limit. I didn't quite understand.
With the artist proof, an AP, that you'll see, an artist cannot make more than 10 to 15% of the edition as artist proof. An artist proof is outside the edition, but they can't keep on making a lot of APs.
Are they signed also?
Yes. The artist proof is signed, but it says AP.
Right. And it's not numbered.
No.
Is it more valuable or less valuable?
Less valuable. I think it's less. I don't know. You know what? I don't know. Things have changed. I can't. But
You don't know either. Yeah.
No, I did know. It's just it's unless somebody thought it was going to be a good thing to have the artist's exploration, you're going for the quality of the edition.
Yeah.
And once it usually artist proofs are working up to saying, okay, this is the way I want it.
Yeah.
So they're usually considered, I don't want to use the word inferior, but they then get to their standard and they use that as a guide and
yeah.
then print the edition.
Somebody asks, you're printing your print and then what makes the edition? You may pull some things out of the edition that you don't want to be in the edition because
right.
they didn't come out exactly
it
the way you wanted
it. Might be lighter
and
then it wouldn't be part of the edition.
Yeah, yeah. So, the lower number indicates the size of the edition. Excuse me. And the upper number indicates which one it is. So the prizes are the first, second, third, fourth, fifth one. So when you're buying them, you know, you look at that. And if it's a big edition, it really isn't that valuable. Some things accrue in value. I was telling somebody that Vince bought a new wall print for me for one of our big anniversaries at Brentano's, and I think he paid $250 for it. And maybe about 5-6 years ago, I was in a gallery on 57th Street, and I saw that print, and it was selling it for $15,000.
Nice.
So it's amazing. Years ago, I'm giving you part of the lecture, but why did a lot of artists get into making prints? Part of it had to do with those who just love printmaking. But some of them felt in the long run they could make more money by pricing it lower but selling a larger amount of the print. Some companies, there used to be a company that people every month bought like print of the month, and they would send original prints to people, but there was such a big addition that they really didn't accrue in value that much. Okay, traditionally the artist signature is on the lower right hand and the numbering of the edition is in the lower left hand. A title may or may not be placed in the center. So you'll see some of these things that are signed and they have, they go just the way I said. So it would be in the left-hand corner, there would be 1/10. Of course, if it was a really small edition, that's going to make it more valuable. And then on the other side, it would be their signature. And then there's something else that you want to consider, that artists sometimes sign the plate. They sign their name in the plate. In fact, I'm going to show you a Picasso. The one thing when you print a plate, when you print whether it's a woodblock or an etching or a lithograph, everything is mirror image. So if you sign your name Picasso and you sign it the way you would sign it, when you printed it, everything would be backwards. That was the toughest thing when I was teaching printmaking to kids in school. It was the toughest thing for them to get the idea of the mirror image. I always tried to explain it to them, because otherwise they said, but that's not the way I imagined it. But so you have to realize that it's a mirror image, except in a silk screen. And in a silk screen, it comes out the way that it was printed. Okay, so what determines the value of a print? It's the artist who made it, the aesthetic qualities, the rarity, the condition of the print, and sometimes if they're not taken care of, prints, I think, originally were not meant to be put on the wall. They were meant to be kept in drawers, and people would take them out, and they would look at them.
And so, so it's the condition of the print too, the size of the edition, the number of the print, the historical importance, and the provenance, who had it, where it came from, if you could prove. Okay, so printmaking was originally used as a form of communication, and it's now valued as an artistic medium. It had its roots in prehistoric times, when humans placed their hands upon the cave wall and blew pulverized clay around it to make an image. Around 500 BC, Sumerians carved images on a cylinder, and that was pressed into wet clay. Multiple impressions would be made using these cylinder seals, which would indicate ownership. And those are examples of them.
Yeah.
Now, the invention of printing took place during the Tang Dynasty in China, which ran from 618 to 906 AD. It began as incised woodblocks used as a way to print textiles, and later Buddhist religious texts. Prior to that, images were carved into huge flat stone slabs. Printed books first began to be made in quantities during the 9th century, and these could be purchased from private dealers. The earliest example of printmaking, and this is the Diamond Sutra, and it's 17 feet long, and it's a scroll, and it was made in China in 868 AD. I don't know, can you see that?
I see that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. By the 17th century, the Chinese mass-produced books, including how-to manuals. These books were brought to Japan, where they influenced the development of Yukijoi prints. It's Y-K-I-Y-O-E. The Y is pronounced with a J. And they're called pictures of the floating world. Japanese printmakers created luminous woodcuts of mythology, everyday life, sumo wrestlers, popular actors, and beautiful courtesans. They were mainly meant for townspeople who were wealthy enough to afford to buy original paintings. These mass-produced prints were thought to be inexpensive throwaways that the tourists could buy almost in the way they bought postcards. Prints, and this is how it came to Europe, prints were made of use in packing materials. So when they were sending the porcelains and what have you from Japan, the way we use styrofoam and what have you, they used crunched up paper prints. And that's how people became aware of these things that they thought of as throwaways. They're beautiful, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. So these prints really strongly influenced European artists and printmakers and became a major source of inspiration for the Impressionists, the Post-Impressionists, and the Cubists. In fact, the Japanese aesthetic of flat, solid shapes and dramatic color pattern and design and the use of line as well as asymmetrical composition impacted the work that they created. Now, if I told you this was done by a European artist, you would think it was really done by Japanese. Do you know who this was done by?
Matisse?
No. Van Gogh.
Van Gogh.
Really? Looks a little like clay. I had to go back and check it again. I said, it looks so Japanese.
Yes, very Japanese.
Yes.
But they were really impacted by that aesthetic, you know, with the strong, simple design. And again, you can see where printmaking techniques afforded you to play around with stuff. You know.
I noticed also that his color selection is very simple, primary and secondary colors, like, you know, not like purple, turquoise, and tints and stuff, very Japanese-y color, you know, like the red, the bold red, the bold black, the yellow.
Now, where did you say this?
She means this.
Oh, yeah.
I said this.
Yes, yes, I'm sorry.
The prints itself.
Yes, the colors itself. This is Mary Cassatt, and this is called The Woman Bathing, and it's a dry point etching, and then it was colored in, so that the lines, dry point means you take, when you have a plate, you can either carve into the plate with a tool and make lines, and it's not etched that way. You take your tool and you carve into the plate, and especially with a copper plate, it's easy to do. And I have over here an example. I have an acrylic plate that somebody did, where you can also use this pointy tool to do it, and it's dry point because you don't do any using and you don't use any acid. And the other one is called the letter, and that's a dry point and something called aquatint. Aquatint is another thing that an artist would use to develop tone. So they take rosin, that, you know, like rosin, when you put rosin on a violin bow, well, this one is rosin that's like pulverized, and you shake it onto the plate where you want to develop a tone. I can go over and point out some of the areas that actually had that done. So you shake this rosin on the plate, and then you heat it, and it adheres to the plate. And then you put it in an acid bath, and the acid starts eating away the plate wherever the rosin did not melt on top of it. And sometimes people have actually even used spray paint. You have to, it's a matter of controlling how you do this in order to get the tone. And again, the longer you leave it in the acid bath, the deeper and richer the tone is. Yeah.
So on the letter print, where would that affect?
When I look at this,
I would
think that was an aquatint. This is very, this is very Japanesey also. And again, she worked with big shapes, simplified shapes. And who's this?
Toulouse-Lautrec.
And again, look at the shape. These are lithographs. These were used as posters for when he was in Paris. The most important of the Japanese printmaker was Hokusai, Hokusai, who produced some 35,000 drawings and prints in the last half of the 17th century, or the beginning of the 18th century. Many of them are now considered masterpieces. Most people are familiar with that. Printmaking in Europe, so we're looking at the Japanese and the Chinese, but there was printmaking that was going on in Europe before the Impressionists, and it began as early as the 16th century. However, although the Chinese had invented paper around 105 AD, printmaking on paper in Europe didn't take place until the technology for making paper arrived, and that was in 1150. So that was a long span between doing prints on paper and what they had done before. The first woodcuts printed on paper were playing cards produced in Germany in the early 15th century. However, printmaking was used mostly to inexpensively distribute Christian images to the common people. Again, it was always thought of as an inexpensive way of getting things done. from metal engraving was introduced several decades after the woodcut. These prints were more refined and soon became the most popular method of serial printing. This type of printing reached its zenith in the 16th century in the hands of Albert Durer. Now, you take a look at these prints and how detailed they are. Either they were you had wood engravings which were done on the end cut of wood, of a very hard wood, and they incised them, or they were done on a metal plate and they had a tool called a burn, and you pushed it in, and it really, you can make very precise and deep lines, and they were able to get this kind of imagery. Acid etching was introduced in the 17th century and quickly became a way to produce intaglio prints. This was because the artists of the day considered it more creative and less commercial, and therefore a more noble technique for making art. The leading artist of that period was Rembrandt, who produced approximately 300 plates. And when you look at Rembrandt prints, what's really interesting, you can many times see the process, like he'll have more than one stake. And because in a plate, you can actually, if you use the right tool, you can actually get rid of certain parts and highlight certain other parts. And you can see that with his prints. This is not complete, but you can see. This is unfinished. I think the one, the night watch, and I've seen, is that the one where you can really see where he scraped out areas and very much changed. The late 19th century saw the emergence of the artist printmaker in Europe and the United States. Artists such as Goya, Degas, Whistler, Audubon, Cassatt, Monet, and Toulouse-Lautrec were actively involved in printmaking. Pablo Picasso made more than 2,000 prints using various printmaking techniques. He also published 163 art books containing his original prints, and also the Expressionists did a lot of printmaking. So this is a lino cut, if I was called. Mm-hmm. And this is an etching. You asked about getting in this kind of tone. That's where you would use aquatint.
What kind of plate is liner print?
Oh, linoleum print.
Linoleum.
Yeah, and Picasso developed a very interesting kind of linoleum print. It's called a reduction print. You know, when you want to print. If you want to print something, it's easy to do, not easy, but you black and white, you use the brayer and you put the ink on and it's you print it. When you want to do color prints, every single layer usually is a different plate or a different block, and you have to get it so that it matches exactly. These are four blocks that were used to register it, and it's a perfect registration. So you print one color on top of another color on top of another color. What Picasso did in his invention was he made a design, and then he cut away, he printed it. Then he cut away for the next color. So, and then the next color and the next color, and he printed each one on top. At the end, you had to decide, I'm going to do 25 prints. And that's all you could do, because at the end, after you cut away each layer, instead of making a separate plate, It's all on the one plate. So when you're planning this addition, say it was an addition of 25, you wouldn't only make, on the original ones, you wouldn't only make 25 prints because you never know whether you get the registration off. I mean, there are ways in which I have a registration form that I use, but that's what you had to do because at the end, you could not, it's the end of your print. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
That's very, very interesting. But it also makes it, I think this has got to be a reduction print because of the way one thing goes on top of the other. Interestingly enough, as a teacher, I used to do linoleum prints with the kids, but I also did the woodblocks. But there is now, with the new technology, there are plates that have come out that are like almost like an eraser. And when a kid cuts into them, it makes it so much easier for them to print. So rather than using, like if you had linoleum, sometimes you had to heat it up to make it soft enough for the children to print, or even for yourself to print. Now it's like, when we got all finished with them, we used to cut them up and use them as erasers.
Well, with the wood cutting, you're using a tool and cutting into wood.
Yeah.
And as you described, sometimes the first line is the outline.
Yeah.
And that tool, is that easy? I mean, I've sculpted and I've killed myself trying to sculpt a head out of wood. How do the kids manage to do, is it very
I didn't know how much to bring. I was going to bring the tools, but there are particular tools that you use to gouge out. Mm-hmm. Some have a V in it, they make a thin line. Mm-hmm. Some are shaped like this, mm-hmm. and it's you can pull out more. And then what you do with your tool is you have a place where you sharpen it, a sharpening stone. So you put a little oil on the sharpening stone, and you use the tool.
Is the wood very hard?
Sure.
No. I use pine. When the wood is very hard, when they use the end cut to make an engraving, that's why hardly anybody does engraving anymore because it's too time consuming and what have you to cut through that.
Mm-hmm.
So pine is easy. Sometimes people use plywood.
I don't understand. How many passes do you have to make to get the different colors on?
How many passes?
Yeah.
Well, you decide how many colors you want.
Yeah, and
like
each.
I decided. I first made a drawing of this.
Three colors.
And this is the order. Something
around.
A memory from Southampton. And then I made the drawing, then I made it in color.
I made the drawing in color. Yeah.
And then I decided how to separate those colors. And then I transferred the sections onto a block. So I had this section was blue. I cut away everything except that blue, that shape, and I printed it. And then at the very end, you usually start with a light color and you build up. At the very end, you can see it closer, I cut away everything except the black lines that I wanted printed. And I printed that on top of, I don't print this way, I print it on top. This way, I printed all of those lines. You have to break it down. That's why I said you have to pre-visualize what your colors are.
And if you're going to make 25 prints, do you keep on refreshing the paint or the ink?
Yes.
If I was going to make 25 prints, I would make 25. I'd make more than 25 of one color. Then I would do the second color on top of that. I would do them all at the same time. Then I would do the third color. And then I did the fourth color. So this was one. Two, three, four. And I printed each one individually on top of the other. Some more Picassos. This is a mono print.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the mono prints, and what we're going to be talking about is the thing that they give you is the painterly quality. But you only get, well, you're only supposed to get one, you get two prints out of it. And it was, what's interesting is that what changed with mono prints is when I first started doing printmaking, when I did mono prints, I used oil-based paints. And when now, when I do mono prints, I use water-based paints.
Why?
So it changes the whole thing. Well, certain things are nice. As if, for instance, these were done with oil-based paints. And then some of it was hand colored and what have you. These were done with water-based paints. You get an absolutely different type of feeling. And with the water-based paint, this is the other interesting thing. With the oil-based paint, when you print a mono print, you print it while the oil is wet, it hasn't dried. With the water-based paint, you can work on a plate as if you were working on a painting. You can work on it, but you have to kind of think again in terms of layer, because you put a piece of wet paper down and it pulls off the part of the image. So although these two were made from the same plate, one being the ghost and one being, that's what that's called, you get an entirely different look because of the paint that was pulled off. I don't know whether I'm confusing you.
What is the ghost again?
What is the ghost?
Yes.
The ghost is the second print of a mono print. But sometimes, especially when you have the water-based paint, you can pull a print, you can go back into your plate and paint watercolor again, and let it dry, and then print it again. There's a technology in printmaking has really come a long way.
And if you pull it off on canvas or something that has a texture to it, the ghost then has that texture besides.
Well, yeah, when you do an etching, as a for instance, if you're doing an etching, you can put what's called a hard ground on, which is, it's really like putting a varnish on, right? Then you would take a needle. I used to use a dissecting needle, from science class. And you can draw with that needle, and you could expose a line. So you could make it. You can make it very linear. I don't know whether that was done that way, but I'm just saying you could expose a line. Then, Joyce Marie, there's something called a soft ground etching. And you put this soft ground on. You can take fabric, you can take all kinds of stuff, and you could press it into the soft ground, and then you get a texture of whatever that was. You might be able to do that with your felting. Never thought about that.
What kind of plate is used for the watercolor? Is that glass or?
No, that's another interesting thing. Some people will use an acrylic plate. I used to buy for the kids. I'd go to the hardware store and buy windows. Mm. The window replacement, and you can use that. You have to rough it up so that the paint will stick to the plate.
Sand it?
You sand it, yes. You use sandpaper, or sometimes people mix a little soap in with the paint, and it sticks onto the plate. Mm. Then there are.
You use liquidy watercolor or?
Yeah, I use regular, that was just regular watercolor paint there. Mm-hmm. But again, this is the new, there are new products are out. There's a company called Akura, and they have all kinds of water-based paints, and they're doing all kinds of technology and beautiful paints. Mm-hmm. And yeah.
Have you tried the jelly plate? The jelly plate, have you heard of that?
No, I haven't tried that.
It's like a gel. It's a big, you buy the square and you print off of it. It's awesome. It's like those cling things for the windows. It's
yeah.
a really funny, you know, material, and it's a whole new.
Oh,
yeah.
I haven't tried that, but what I like to do, but so people like to use the acrylic plates because they can put, especially it makes them feel secure, they put a drawing underneath.
Ooh.
And then they can paint on top of it. I like to use a lithography plate. It's a plate that they use, most people use to do lithographs. Mm. And it's a metal plate, and it's got a texture, it's rough on the top. Why I like to use it when I do the water-based paint is that it, because it's got this kind of tooth, it holds the paint. So I can get really rich color. Okay, so now you see these are all the German expressionists that were working and how they use the, you know, the woodcut or the etching. And one of the famous, do you know who this is?
Kathy Collins.
Kathy Collins. She was a wonderful printmaker, and in fact, then the Nazis got after her, but she did a lot of, she taught that in the Bauhaus.
Fantastic stuff.
So.
Look at this.
Okay, so in the 60s we saw the rise of specialized graphic workshops. Here the major abstract expressionist artists gathered to make prints while working closely with a master printer. Printmaking and mass production appealed to the pop artists who created imaginative imagery. Of course, this is the famous Andy Warhol, Campbell's soup cans.
Yes.
Before Warhol, most of the portraits were done a certain way. But he, using silk screens, really changed the way one looked at portraits. So that's Liz Taylor, and a multiple of Marilyn Monroe.
What is a silk screen?
These are silk screen. Oh, what is a silk screen? You know, I'm sorry I didn't bring one. What a silk screen is, it's literally, it's a frame, thank you, and it's got silk on it, or if it's not silk, it's some kind of a fine material where you can push ink through it. So the way a silk screen works is you make a stencil, and you can either do it, if you're only going to make a few copies, you can make a paper stencil, cut it out, put it under the screen, you pull with a squeegee, you pull the ink through the stencil, and it prints. But you can only get a few prints from that. Otherwise, I always said to the kids, it looked like an apricot sheet. So you could actually cut a stencil, which you use acetone to attach it to the screen, and then you could make many copies with the silk screen. But the problem with that is that the acetone is you have to be in really well ventilated rooms, and you usually what you're working with is you have oil-based paint, so it's a messy thing to clean up afterwards. But it's got its advantages. You don't get mirror image, you get everything straight on. You can print. Like, what he's done here is each of these colors represents a different screen that gets printed on top and on top. Also with silk screen, you get this kind of flat. It's a different kind of a look.
Mm-hmm.
It's a flat, you don't get tonality in it. where they create the tones is by just sort of doing this. But now a lot of people go and they get photo silk screens. They can. I've done the actual photo silk screen where I take something that's sensitive to the light, and the light goes. You have a negative, and you literally make a stencil from the light, and then you attach it to the screen. So that, or you can actually, some people just go and they have it done. They'll bring it to a shop, and they'll ask them to make the screen, and then they'll print from it. So you can do it actually use, and you'll see Robert Rauschenberg, I'm gonna show you some of his pieces, use photo silk screen all the time. If you want to add anything.
you can draw on the screen too.
Right? Yes, you can, that's right. I didn't think about that. Right. You can draw on the screen.
So you're blocking it out. Right. You're blocking the screen so that when you squeegee the ink over the screen, it's going everywhere.
And you actually can, people not only draw, but I have also painted.
Yeah.
So you use a block out. And this is Robert Rauschenberg. And he was one of the artists that really used a lot of printmaking. And he called these, I think, combines. And some of it is, I think this is photo screen here. But he did it, instead of doing just one piece, he did several silk screens on his canvas. Well, he did it on canvas, he did it on paper, he did it on fabric. I'm going to show you one on fabric. Okay, so we kind of went through a lot of these. There's the relief, which is a relief print is called the wood print or a liner cut. The intaglio, or the etching and engraving. The lithograph, this is done on either a copper plate or a zinc plate or an acetate plate that's been dry point. A lithograph is done on a stone, so it's a big stone, and it works on the process of the ink, water and oil reject one another, and you actually etch the stone, and then when you're all finished, and you want to use it again, you have a tool that's got a piece on the top there, and you do this, and you actually wear away the stone so that you can reuse the etching stones here. Big, heavy stones. A collagraph is like making a collage. You can use different materials and add different kinds of things, and you can print from that. It's called the collagraph. So when you're finished, you can take a look at it. Embossing. Embossing doesn't really take any ink, but this is an embossing. Or you can do embossings. If you look at this etching plate, it's got a very deep bite, meaning it's really been in acid for a very long time. And you can actually, if you look at that plate, it was an acid at different times, deeper and deeper, so that I've actually printed that as an embossing with no ink. You don't usually have any ink on the embossing. We went through the monotype. They're now doing digital printing, but there's a big question: is that real printmaking or not? The technology is in question. And there's mixed media, where artists, and I'm going to show you examples of that, where artists use all different kinds of media. And that's a fresco also, a multiple woodblock. And he has done some wonderful with, I think he did a stamp, if I'm not mistaken, with the birds. Both of these are lino cuts. This is a Picasso reduction print. And this is somebody named Elizabeth Catlett. And she did some very, she's a black artist, and she did some really wonderfully intricate relief. Now remember, a relief print is you're printing from the surface, where an etching, you're printing from what you've incised, so that on a relief print, you roll it and you print the surface. On an etching, you press the paper into the lines that have been cut and you pull out the ink. It's just the opposite. That is a Matisse, and that's a lino cut. I had to think twice because it looked like it could have been. There's a way of doing a lino print, which I used to love, where you take the plate and you
cover the whole plate
with the ink. And then you can either just take a pencil or some kind of a blunt, a piece of wood, and you can draw into it, and you pull up the ink, and then you print it. That's almost what that looks like, but I double-checked, and it is a lino cut.
It doesn't look like it.
The difference being that he could make lots of these prints, but if he did it the other way, he could only make one. Okay, this is an engraving, and again, it's the detail, sorry, you can't really see well, it's the small lines and the details that that you can get with an engraving. Interestingly enough, a wood engraving is like a relief engraving. You print it from the top. A metal engraving is when you use the burin, and then you press the paper through a press, you press the paper into the line, and then you pull it out. So they're both engravings, except when you do it with wood, it becomes relief, and when you do it with metal, it becomes a metal. His name is Jim Dine. He's famous for, in fact, I'm going to show in the mixed media, he's famous, he gets themes. So he had the heart as a theme, he had bathrobes as a theme, and he did a whole suite of work using tools. This is a lithograph, Calder and Miro. Again, I'll read it so that. So a lithograph is what's called a planographic print. Which means that the surface from which it is printed is flat. The image is drawn on limestone or a specifically prepared metal plate with a greasy medium. The surface is then treated with chemicals and dampened with water so that the oil-based printing ink, when rolled on, will adhere only to the marks made by the greasy medium. And painterly effects and a variety of lines can be produced using this method. And believe it or not, that's a Picasso lithograph. Okay, so another word for silkscreen is serigraph. And it's a form of stencil printing where a stencil is adhered to a fine screen for support. The ink is pressed through the screen with a rubber squeegee. The colors are flat and unshaded. It can be done on many different kinds of materials and can be produced photographically. I had to double check on this one. This is MOOC.
That's the screen.
MOOC.
And you see so many versions of the screen.
Yeah, usually it's.
And I double checked because I thought it almost looked like it could have been a woodcut.
Yeah, it does.
But it actually is a silk screen.
Wow.
So it's more than one silk screen. This is, you know, the famous. Warhol did a whole lot of Mao. I don't know. Can you read that? I didn't know.
It starts with a C, Natalie. C O something.
I couldn't figure out who
love,
it was.
Love.
Good. One of the best friends with Robert Rauschenberg was Jasper Johns. And you see how how they allow certain things to happen. I mean, that's done on purpose.
Oh, yeah, like that's what he said.
Lord. This is another Rauschenberg. There it is, Rauschenberg. Mm. When I said he began from here, I know he went on a trip to the Orient and he picked up a lot of the images that he used in paintings from there, but he just put things one on top of the other and absolutely incredible results. Collagraph. That's what I showed, that's the plate I showed you. This is a John Ross. This is his wife, Claire Romano. And you build up the plate. It's all different materials that you build up. I included this one, and I don't know whether you can see it here, but somebody actually pasted a blouse onto a piece of a board, and then printed it. This one you can see where they have a string printed.
Yeah.
So a collagraph you can have it so many layers that you end up, it can almost be like an embossing. If you look at that, it almost has an embossing-like quality. And by rubbing ink into the edges, you're doing intaglio, you're doing an etching. So it's kind of an interesting process. And teaching children, it's a good way of introducing them. So he would do the monoprint. He would paint he used oil-based paint. And then when he got finished, he would very often work over them with pastels.
Uh-huh.
And it's interesting. I know I've done this where when you work on the paper is wet when you're doing the monoprint. So when you work over it with a pastel, you get a different kind of a quality than you would get from a regular pastel. You make a monoprint and you could wipe off sections. You could go with the edge of your brush and take out sections, or you could paint on top of it. Then there's the mixed medium. This one is a Robert Motherwell, and let's see, what is it? I don't know all the medium. It almost looks like a monoprint, doesn't it? But it's not. It's a variety of medium. And then we come to my friend Jim Don.
Yeah. I own that, Matt, in white.
You have that?
In white.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
Well,
I gave it to my daughter.
Yeah, what?
I inherited it.
Hey, this
white.
Is a woodcut, a collagraph, and it's hand painted.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Okay. Isn't that amazing? That's beautiful.
He's still alive.
Gordon.
And this is Audrey Flack. And she used a digital print, and then she did additive stuff to the digital print. And we're going to end the talk with Robert Rauschenberg, where he really does mixed media. He did a series with this fabric, and then you can see they're stitched together. Some of these are partial photo silk screens. So that the possibilities are really endless to what you could do with printmaking. And if you have any questions or want to ask me anything,
thank you.